Urban wetlands live in the shadows of cities. For many years, these natural areas were heavily polluted and considered worthless.
Most people looked at wetlands as an eyesore, as a swamp, as a mosquito-infested place.
What good are they? They're not producing tax revenue. We can't build on them. Why should we have to have them here?
People's attitude about it back then was, let's get rid of it, let's fill it in. It's a bad place.
Now the tide is turning as people discover the value of wetlands on the city's edge.
When you go under the trestle from the sound of the highway and the hustle bustle, and all of a sudden you have this open waterway and all this beautiful green, it's a shock.
You come out here and you see the wildlife and you sort of forget about the metropolitan area. It is truly an urban wilderness.
Every day, millions of people across the United States travel past wetlands on their way to work. The view from a car or train is often all they see of a very complex world. Urban wetlands are extraordinary places to discover, filled with a great variety of plants and animals that live right alongside buildings and bridges. This intriguing landscape is attracting modern-day explorers who want to see firsthand what exists below the highway. Only a few miles from New York City, you will find one of the largest urban wetlands in the country. Known as the Meadowlands, this vast expanse of more than 8,000 acres is surrounded by cities and towns. In the 20th century, heavy industry and numerous landfills created a toxic environment in parts of the Meadowlands.
People didn't realize the value of a wetland.
While pollution is still an issue, this urban wetland is experiencing a dramatic transformation through the combined efforts of legislation, planning, and open space preservation. Now, boat tours and hiking trails bring people into the Meadowlands to see the successful changes.
More and more, the site just is naturally coming back on its own.
We call it our mini Everglades tour. You might be cruising through a narrow tidal area, and it looks just like you're cruising in the middle of the Everglades, and you're getting into these niches that you wouldn't get into without a boat or a canoe.
The most common sentence that I hear from people is, "I never knew this was here." The funny part of that is they've been living around the Meadowlands for a good part of their life. Hundreds of thousands of people every day pass through the Meadowlands. Very few of those people have any idea that while they're doing 75 miles an hour across the Sawmill Creek, 25 or 30 feet away at the base of the culvert, there may be a yellow-crowned night heron fishing.
They're just so surprised that all of this life exists in the Meadowlands. They don't remember it that way. They remember the pollution. They know about the development. They know about the landfilling. And therefore, they think, oh, it's gone. There's no area here worth exploring.
The majority of the Meadowlands is tidal salt marsh. Twice a day, great volumes of water leave the wetlands and reveal an open expanse of mudflats. The receding water flows into the Hackensack River and continues on to Newark Bay, providing fresh oxygen and nutrients. The returning tide brings salt water into the river, creating a brackish environment in the wetlands.
Wetlands, especially coastal wetlands like we have here in the Meadowlands, are one of the most dynamic ecosystems on the planet. 75% of the fish that we catch commercially and recreationally depend on wetland ecosystems to complete their life cycle.
Only a few centuries ago, the majority of the Meadowlands was a freshwater cedar swamp. Over the years, the ecosystem changed as people tried to develop the land and control the water by cutting down trees, building dikes, and eventually constructing a dam on the Hackensack River. All that remains of the ancient cedars today are time-worn stumps that appear at low tide.
I'm always awed by the stumps as many times as I've seen them. I look at them, I say, my God, how, you know, you'd be out in a bright, sunny day like today, and back then, and you would have been in the same area in nothing but shade. The trees would have been so dense.
And right over in here, a lot.
Don Smith explored the Meadowlands as a child.
Just interior, right here.
His knowledge of this urban wilderness led to a career working to preserve it. Over the years, he helped to teach people about the value of wetlands by taking them on boat trips.
They would get close to egrets and herons and see a muskrat swimming with a mouthful of food. And at times, on a nice clear afternoon or evening with the New York skyline right in the background, it was a definite contrast. But it made them appreciate it much more. I always ended the boat trips by saying, I thank you for letting me show you your meadows. Then they would get the point that this is theirs.
Many miles south of the Meadowlands, along the Delaware River, lies a much smaller urban wetland. The Hamilton-Trenton Marsh is 1,250 acres in size and is located downstream from the state capital of New Jersey. This urban wetland was not as severely polluted as the Meadowlands and is a freshwater marsh fed by the tides in the Delaware River.
Oftentimes people, when they hear the word tides, want to think it's in case of salt water, but because it's freshwater and you don't have the limiting features of salinity, you get a large diversity of plants.
The tides bring in a variety of seeds and create a dynamic environment that constantly changes.
The real quality of the marsh is that it has the water, and the water brings all sorts of life. You get the fishes associated with the water, and because of the fish-eating mammals, the birds, certain plant species, endangered plants, certain unusual insects. The richness of life within the marsh is spectacular.
Does anybody else want a feather to hold?
The husband and wife team of Drs. Mary and Charles Leck has studied the marsh for more than 30 years. In that time, Mary has identified nearly 900 species of plants.
Narrowleaf cattail, that is...
It's just fascinating that we have a kind of ecosystem here in our backyard that is so highly productive. There's just so much plant material that's produced in one year. If you go out there in the spring, it looks like there's nothing there, and if you go back in the summer, I mean, you have these plants that may be 10 feet tall.
Wild rice is an annual grass, and it grows, this one, I don't know, is maybe 6 feet tall or so, but it can grow, you know, 8 or more feet, and it doesn't all in one year, so it's pretty remarkable.
Because you have very high plant productivity, there's luxuriant plant growth, the amount of plant material that's produced in one year rivals tropical rainforests. Some of that material is certainly used in the marsh by animals, but a lot of it gets into the water system, goes down into Delaware Bay as what's known as detritus, and that becomes part of the aquatic food chains in Delaware Bay.
Tidal freshwater marshes have high plant species diversity.
The Lex work closely with the citizens group Friends for the Marsh, which brings people out to discover the little-known world of the urban wetland on walking tours and by riding the tides.
You have a tide coming in because now you're having nature work for you. It takes you right up the creek beautifully, and then if you wait for the high tide to change back the other way, it takes you right back out.
We'll find some more that I can reach.
Being in a canoe gives people a different appreciation because you're actually out on the water and you can see wetland areas really close up.
They love it. They can't believe that this little paradise is so close to where they live. Of course, when the eagle flies over, that's very special.
Here's the eagle.
The eagle usually flies over when we have large groups.
The contrast of nature and city gives people a new perspective as they travel through the wilderness areas alongside a vast transportation system of bridges, railroads, and highways.
I think it's sort of an awesome feeling. I mean, you're going from bright sunlight oftentimes to being really almost in a cave because those places are so big. I mean, they're really big bridges that you're going under. People oftentimes, if they've not been there before, are truly amazed at the diversity and expanse of the wetlands. It's a fairly substantial area in a very urbanized setting.
Both the marsh and the meadowlands are integral parts of a rich network of wetlands found around the world. Wetlands are places of mystery. Not quite land and not quite water, they exist as a delicate balance between the two. There are many different types of wetlands, including swamps, marshes, and meadows. All wetlands share a common lifeblood. Water. Behind their deceptively tranquil appearance lies a whirlwind of activity that provides numerous benefits for humans and wildlife.
The wetlands are one of the world's most valuable resources because they are the vital link between land and water. And as a result of that linkage, they're important for fish, shellfish, and wildlife that we either appreciate from an aesthetic standpoint or that we like to eat.
Wetlands can hold countless numbers of times their weight in water when there's a big storm surge that comes in. And when there's a big, wet, flat area that storm surge can fill up, that's much better than having it fill up somebody's basement or somebody's business.
Wetlands downstream of urban areas serve as important pollution filters because the water that runs off of the impervious surfaces, the streets, the buildings, and so on, contains a lot of pollutants. That ends up going directly into the rivers and moves downstream then into a wetland area. And the wetlands, actually by slowing the flow of water, by removing sediments, and those pollutants are attached to those sediments, so they serve as pollution filters and really end up making the waters cleaner.
Scientific studies have documented that wetlands also produce significant amounts of oxygen every day. In essence, they make the water we drink and the air we breathe cleaner. Despite the vital role wetlands play in sustaining life, they continue to be developed. Since the time of the Pilgrims, more than half of the wetlands in the lower 48 states have been destroyed. Urban wetlands remained under constant pressure to be made useful because of their close proximity to large populations. In the 20th century, many of these sites became dumping grounds for both heavy industry and household garbage. The Meadowlands was extremely hard hit.
If humans made it, we had it. We had everything from like raw sewage in some places in sea caucus to some little ponds of cyanide.
There was always an acrid smell in the air, mostly from the garbage burning and rotting out there, because in those days they didn't even cover the garbage up when they got done dumping it. They would just drive away and leave it to rot.
Going into the landfill was not only all the household garbage, but there were a lot of industrial waste going in there and liquid waste. They were bringing in 3,000-gallon tanker trucks, and they'd pay their fee, drive up on a landfill, open a valve, and let the liquid waste toxins run out and soak through the landfill. The landfill generates a liquid waste in itself called leachate, and that leachate percolates through the landfill and then runs into the adjacent receiving waters and has a serious detrimental quality on the water. Except for a few people in the country, I guess, we were very ignorant of what we were doing as a society. There was very little, almost no thought given to the waste that was being generated and where it was going.
As the significance of wetlands became more apparent, both individual states and the federal government began to enact laws that offered greater protection. Among the most notable was the Federal Clean Water Act of the 1970s.
The Clean Water Act was significant for wetlands because it recognized the value of wetlands at cleaning the nation's waters, and then would prevent or try to regulate at least activities that would end up destroying wetlands and thereby removing these valuable pollution filters.
Environmental legislation that developed over the next few decades strengthened the ability to fight pollution, clean up toxic waste sites, and close landfills. In 2004, the Meadowlands saw a major change in development attitudes. Following in the tradition of the Clean Water Act, the New Jersey Meadowlands Commission made a break with past regulations and zoned 8,400 acres of wetlands for conservation. This has set in motion an effort to create an environmental preserve 10 times the size of New York City's Central Park. At the Hamilton-Trenton Marsh, wetlands laws protected the fragile environment by minimizing the impact of a new highway built in the 1990s.
The construction that we see is certainly much better than would have occurred many years ago. They've tried to keep the highway elevated so that water flow is not inhibited. And that's been critical for keeping the flow into the back areas of the marsh and keeping it open for canoeing and all sorts of activities.
One thing that's interesting on those overpasses is that they're nesting cliff swallows. So a rare species is actually used, a construction of man.
Legislation is an essential part of giving new life to urban wetlands. But just as important is the individual effort to change people's attitudes and perceptions.
About two-thirds of the way into a falling tide, this place is jumping with birds. I mean, like, really jumping with birds.
Bill Sheehan started by volunteering for a local environmental commission. He created signs that identified the Hackensack River and its tributaries throughout the Meadowlands as environmentally sensitive.
When I first put them up, I got a lot of responses from the local community. People would say, you put that up by that creek ain't nothing but a sewer. And I'd say, nope, I'm sorry, it's a creek. And once we start thinking of it as an environmental sensitive area, that's the first hurdle we have to get over to get it back to where it's supposed to be.
Growing awareness has evolved into greater action as people volunteer to clean up their local wetlands.
One of the biggest problems we have is stuff that washes into the river from storm drains, stuff that people discard without any conscience. They throw it on the curb thinking that somebody's going to come along and pick it up. We get everything from children's toys to refrigerators, truck tires to other construction debris, and you name it. If it's in use in the outdoors, at some point or other, it winds up floating in the river and gets stuck in the wetlands. And that's the kind of stuff that we go after during the cleanups. It's a very fulfilling program because we're able to demonstrate vividly to the public how non-point source pollution is damaging this resource in recovery.
The spring turtles are hungry and they want to warm up.
Today, learning about the importance of urban wetlands is starting at an early age. Education programs are giving students in city school districts the chance to discover the natural world that exists near their hometowns. This scientific study is an exciting learning opportunity that many earlier generations never had the chance to experience.
What bird? Yeah, what's the name of that bird? Thank you.
When they start to see the birds and they're using their binoculars and they're learning about the birds, it's in the Meadowlands. It's right here in towns you would normally think don't have a natural area, and they do.
We can read all the textbooks we want, but I think the hands-on way you actually see it, you actually test for things, I think that's the most important thing. That changes the attitudes, and that goes home to the parents, I think.
One of the interesting things that we find when kids come out here, whether they're coming from a suburban environment or an urban environment, is that they did not know this kind of ecosystem even existed. Kids from Trenton Central, who are only 5 minutes away, had no clue that there was a Hamilton-Trenton Marsh. And what they all share in common is, this is a pretty neat place.
That it's the actual change in the pH that did that. Okay, you good?
Yeah.
All right, so you have back.
They're very surprised when they look up and see Broad Street and see the city and that they're down here right on the edge of the city, and they're overwhelmed at how clean it is. They make predictions at first, and they say, oh, this is going to be really polluted. It's going to be really dirty. Look at this. Everything is washing off from the city. And then when they look in the water and they find things that really need pretty clean water to live, they're very surprised.
You see the wings are starting to form right here?
And of course, we do experiments in the lab, and that's great. But to come out and see how science plays out in the real world really gives them a different level of understanding.
Because of public education programs across the country and getting more people out, whether it be on a boat in the Hackensack Meadowland or on the Mississippi River or a group of birders up in Montana, people are much, much more aware and appreciative of wetlands today.
The appreciation continues to grow for urban wetlands, especially as wildlife populations slowly return to these areas.
As we go along, you see flocks of red-winged blackbirds feeding on many of the seeds here, on the wild rice seeds. They will come in and there'll be big swarms of them as these plants, as the seeds become ripe. I mean, it's really a preferred food for lots of birds as they migrate. And these wetlands are important food sources for the birds.
Not too many people know that the New Jersey Meadowlands is a very important migration stop-off. Huge numbers of green-winged teal come in, huge numbers of shorebirds and sandpipers come in, and you count these birds, you know, not one, two, three, but by the hundreds.
Shorebirds feast on small creatures found on the open mudflats.
These tidal mudflats are essential to the life cycle of shorebirds. Most of them are breeding in the tundra, subtundra region, and then wintering in mid to southern South America. So there's a lot of energy needed to make those trips back and forth.
Some endangered species in New Jersey are even breeding here and raising their young, like the pied-billed grebe. Nesting platforms help to encourage threatened species like the osprey to breed here too.
Let's see if they turn the corner.
The Meadowlands Commission works with community groups to build hundreds of nest boxes for the American tree swallow.
It's probably a little shallow here.
As fast as we try to put them into the marsh, the swallows are hovering around us and waiting for the boat to move to get into that nest box. It's a great project because people know right away that they are helping a bird that has declined over the years.
Now, more than 250 species of birds spend time in the Meadowlands, a place many once considered to be a dead ecosystem because of all the pollution.
These urban wetlands, they are such a vital resource for fish and wildlife. And I see as development is expanding over the landscape, in many areas, the wetlands are the only area that's left for wildlife. I read something recently about the 13th century Chinese. They refer to small lakes in these cities as ponds of mercy. In some ways, you can look at these urban wetlands as the last place, the last refuge for these animals.
The larger a wetland system is, the better the services it provides to the community. It's flood control, it's filtration of water, it's wildlife habitat, it's open space. And the open space issue is something that cannot be overlooked, especially in urban areas. People need to be able to access open space.
When they visit places like the Meadowlands and the Hamilton-Trenton Marsh, people experience the peaceful effect nature has on the spirit, and they leave with a greater understanding that urban wetlands are not wastelands.
People say, why do you go to the marsh, or how often do you go to the marsh? I frequently respond, not often enough. It's just such a beautiful place. You can go out there anytime and just have a real sense of beauty that comes with having water around and having this diversity of plant life and animal life. And so it just says something to me on a very personal level, and it goes beyond scientific studies.
When I see, you know, flocks of hundreds and hundreds of sandpipers zigzagging over the marsh, that's a wonderful feeling. And in the evening, to watch the flocks of egrets this time of year going down for their evening roost, it's all beautiful. And it's a sight as every bit as good as it is any place in the country to watch things like that.
While many people work to preserve wetlands, The threat to destroy them is ever present. It takes the coordinated efforts of government, local communities, nonprofit groups, and individuals to ensure that wetlands and their life-giving benefits will survive.
If we can do it here in New Jersey, with all the competing interests, with all the millions of people, with all the transportation corridors, with all of the other impacts that are taking place here, if we can save this 8,400 acres of wetlands in the heart of the metropolitan area,